Hey guys, it's Miss Andrea coming to you for our Saturday Kids Worship Video Glow Edition. And I hope that you have been enjoying the nice sunshine and the weather that is warming up and have even gotten outside to go fly a kite.
Oh, let's go fly a kite up to the highest height. Let's go fly a kite and send it soaring up through the atmosphere, up where the air is clear. Oh, let's go fly a kite.
That was so fun. I hope you enjoyed the clip from the original Mary Poppins video. And I just grabbed a little snippet off of the YouTube, and I hope that makes you smile like it does me. If you haven't watched that movie, you should ask your family to help you do that because it's really good. And then go ahead and watch Mary Poppins Returned, the new version that just came out, I think last year. So today is going to be a great day. And I hope that we have a lot of memorable lesson content that you could put into your back pocket and hide into your heart, as God would love to teach you something through our lesson today. But first, let's go to our missions video.
Imagine having the most awesome story in the world, the story of how Jesus changed your life. You want to share it with everyone, right? But when you hit send, your computer says, no connection. Sometimes people are like that too. If they haven't accepted Jesus as their savior, they cannot be connected to God.
So, what happened to me before I was a Christian is like, I don't know how to say it, but I didn't have like contact with God.
If we want to connect with friends like Roberto and tell them about Jesus, then we have to go where they are. Just like the Julian family and our friends at Zoe Church are doing to share Jesus' love with the university students in Sao Paulo, Brazil.
I started going to Zoe, and one thing that made me start thinking about God again is to see how God acts in people's life.
I think Zoe is showing that to know God and to know Christ is a positive thing. It's showing that Christ is love. It's showing that the relationships that we have with each other are built in Christ. And it's showing that there is a way to come closer to God, and that way is through Christ.
There are approximately 1 million college students in Sao Paulo. So how does Zoe Church even start to meet up with so many people who are not connected to God?
Wherever students are, that's where we're gonna go. And we're just ourselves, we're just real. Church is going. Church is not four walls. Church is not a home. Church is not a church building. We meet outside in our backyard. We grew so much in our living room that we had to move.
I think one of the things that's really unique about Zoe is that we want to take the word and we want to take Christ to them. And we can't wait for them to come to us. The Lord never said, come and then make disciples of all nations. Invite them to come and make disciples. He said for us to go. He commanded us to go.
Zoe Church is going all over Sao Paulo. Zoe meets at a bakery. Zoe meets students on campus for lunch. They even meet at coffee shops. There's even a Zoe Cafe where they have Bible studies or just hang out and discuss how Jesus changes lives. Hanging out like this sparks important conversations about life. Students who do not know Jesus personally start to learn how much God does love them. Then they begin to discover how they can love Jesus too.
I think when we take the word of God, we apply it to what's going on in their lives, and they're hungry for it. I think what's going on here is really huge community. And that's what attracted Roberto to this thing.
Well, the first thing that I would say that changed is that it feels really good to just like share your life with God, you know? It's the main thing. I would say that's the most important thing that changed in my life. Also, it gives me a goal, something to follow, like to know what should I do. So, like you can know just knowing about Jesus' life.
It goes back to what Zoe's all about, just going out, you know, and being Christ wherever you are, showing Christ, loving people wherever you are.
Today for our game, it is going to be called Believe It or Not. It is actually based off of the game Two Truths and a Lie. So it goes like this. You don't need any pieces of paper or any supplies for it. You just need people to talk to. And if you want, I will be willing to have a Zoom conference with you so we can play this together, or you could do messaging on your phone with me. I think if your parents have Facebook Messenger, we can look at each other and do that. Or if you have a Samsung, I can do like a FaceTime with you because I have a Samsung phone. But you could play this with anybody you would like. But in the Two Truths or a Lie game, what you are supposed to do is say three things about you and say it to somebody, and they have to guess which is the lie. Believe it or not is what you're challenged to do. Do you believe what they're saying or not? So I'm supposed to say two truths and one made up fact about me. So something like, I have three brothers, I was born in Ohio, and my mom is a singer. So you have to guess which is the lie. I am not going to tell you. You'll have to guess. Believe it or not, that's the challenge. In our Bible story today, it is a story about some people who needed to know what to believe. Just like in our game, you needed to know what to believe. You didn't know two truths or a lie. So for today, we're going to need to know a word, and the word is believe. And we need to know what believe means. And believe means to trust something is true. We learned from Miss Lana that there were some men that Jesus met, and they didn't know it was Jesus because they hadn't seen him since he died. Last they knew, he was dead. But we learned last week that Jesus is alive. Now, people had to know what to believe. I think one of my very favorite stories in the Bible after the resurrection is about the story with the men walking on the road, and Jesus starts walking with them and they don't know who he is. And then all of a sudden, they see who it is when he breaks the bread to pray. It is such an amazing story. And then it says right away, he leaves. And then he appears in our next part of the story. You're going to need your Bible today. Go to John 20. John 20. So as you're turning in your Bible, I'm turning in my Bible. John chapter 20. So Jesus has appeared to Mary, and the other disciples haven't seen him. And then there was some men who did see him, but some of his friends, the disciples, hadn't seen him. And one guy was named Thomas, who said, I don't know what to believe. Last I knew, Jesus was dead. And when Jesus died, he died, right? Because that's what people do. And he then said, I won't believe unless, and then he gave his own things that he required in order to know it was true. So he did appear to the disciples, and when he appeared, he said to them in I'm just going to start in verse 19. So when it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, this is right after Jesus rose from the grave. And when the doors were shut where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, because wouldn't you be afraid if you just watched people kill your best friend? Yes, you would. Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." Here's a quiz question for you. When was another time we heard Jesus say, "Peace," before he died on the cross? Let me know. I bet you can know this answer if you think about the lessons that we've learned. And I'm not going to give you any hints because you should know this. Text me, comment on this video, call me, and let me know. I'll get you a prize. Verse 20, and when he had said this, he showed them both his hands and his side. His disciples then rejoiced when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you." And when he said this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. And if you forgive the sins of any, their sins have been forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they have been retained." But Thomas, one of the 12, this is what I was talking about, was not with them when Jesus came. Verse 25. So the other disciples were saying to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said, "Unless I see his hands in the imprint of the nails, and put my fingers in the place of the nails, and put my hand in his side, I will not believe." So, believe it or not, Thomas needed to see to believe. Let's see what happens with the rest of the story.
Jesus is alive! On the same night, his disciples heard that Jesus was alive. They gathered together in a secret place with the door securely locked. They were afraid of the people who had arrested and put Jesus to death. I mean, come on now, I'd be scared too if I'd seen them hurt Jesus. I mean, wouldn't you? Suddenly, Jesus was with them.
"Peace be with you," Jesus said.
He showed the disciples where his hands and sides were hurt when he was put on the cross. The disciples were very glad to see Jesus. Jesus explained that he was sending them to tell others. He promised to send the Holy Spirit. He told the disciples to forgive others. Thomas, one of Jesus' disciples, was not with the group. When the other disciples told Thomas what had happened, he did not believe them. Thomas insisted, "If I don't see and feel the marks that the nails made in his hands and side, I will not believe it." Thomas is like my little brother. He never believes me, and I always tell the truth. I mean, come on now. 8 days later, the disciples were together, and this time, Thomas was with them. And guess who was about to get a giant old surprise? Can I get a tea for Thomas? The door was locked, but that did not stop Jesus from coming and standing with the disciples.
"Peace, peace be with you," Jesus said.
Then Jesus went to Thomas.
"Put your fingers on my hands and look at them. Put your hands into my side. Believe in me."
Thomas realized that it was all true. Jesus was alive. Jesus had died, but he rose again and was standing next to him. Thomas exclaimed, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to Thomas,
"You believe because you have seen me for yourself. Blessed are those who have not seen and still believe. Jesus did many other things when he appeared to his disciples after the resurrection. Jesus' disciple, John, wrote this gospel so that many people may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Savior, who gives eternal life.
Our life point for today is people can believe that Jesus is the Savior. Our Bible verse is one that you're familiar with, I'm sure, but you should know it by heart. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. John 3:16. Before we end our lesson for today, I want you to be able to understand this Bible verse, so we're going to break it down. Because this is how you're going to be able to help people who do not yet believe in Jesus. So the first question I want you to be able to answer and then even ask people who don't believe is, based off of this verse, whom does God love? Looking at the Bible verse, you can see in the very first words, God so loved the world. So the answer is the world. Are you included in the world? Yes, you are. So God loves you. The next question is, how do we know that God loved the world? Well, the answer is in the next part of the verse, because he sent his one and only Son. That is a huge sacrifice. Why would God send his Son if he didn't love us a whole lot? And then, because of all that we've already learned with our ABCs of becoming a Christian, we know that the third part is important too, that whoever believes in him should not perish. That means they won't die. So the question has to be, how can I have eternal life? Well, you have to believe on him. A, B, C. Admit you are a sinner. B, believe that Jesus is God's Son and that he died on the cross for you. And C, confess. And when you confess, the promise is at the end of this verse. How do I know that I'm going to be forgiven? Because it says that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. That means they will live. They won't die in their sin anymore. So that is good news. Have you been to the eye doctor and seen an eye test like this? The eye test is very simple, and you have to be able to read it and believe. Our theme today, yes, is that people can believe that Jesus is the Savior, but it's also, do you believe? Do you believe in this whole story? Believe it or not, it is the truth, and I'm not lying. It is the truth, and I am so excited that I've been able to share the truth with you. So, as we go forward into this week, pray that you will look for somebody that you can play two truths and a lie with, but also to tell them the good news, that all they need is Jesus, and they can know him today because of the Bible verse that you learned. And because of the eyewitness testimony that Jesus is alive. It's true. It's all true. We love you and we're thankful for you. And I hope that you will have a great week. And it was a very good time seeing some of you at our drive-through on Wednesday. And I hope that you have plans to have fun with your family. Of course, I'm going to leave you with one little video that will close us out of reminding you of how silly Miss Angie is. Enjoy.